Hello, my name is Herb Blitzer, and I am going to give a presentation to an audience here at Wolf Technical Services, a forensic engineering company in Indianapolis. It's a replay of a presentation that I made at a conference sponsored by the Wrongful Conviction Advisory Board at the law school in Indianapolis. Francis Watson, who is the director of that board, cannot be here today, so this will be not as egregiously long as it was the first time. nothing against Fran, she's wonderful. That conference was in June of this year, and it covered a synopsis of a report from the National Academies of Science with a title like you see on the top of the current slide. Next slide, please. Congress funded the study to find out what the state of the art of forensic science in the U.S. was and to find a path forward. It was assigned to the National Academies of Science, and 4 years after the money was available, they published a report, and you see a picture of that book, which anyone can buy. Next slide, please. I will give a summary of the findings just very, very briefly. I'm going to then do a sideshow, kind of what is a scientific finding, because the Academy found lapses in science. I want to be sure that you understand what those might be. Then we will walk through several of the traditional forensic science disciplines. If we'll do them all, we will never finish. Then some general conclusions and some of the next steps, many of which are currently taking form right now. Next slide, please. Summary of the findings, right off the top. Except for DNA analysis, all of the other forensic science disciplines lacking in fundamental science. The opinion statements given by experts testifying should reflect this. They should avoid overstating probability by stating that the finding is absolutely correct or implying that. They should state a calculated probability. If it's truly scientific, they should be able to do this. Work should be done to correct these situations, and the agency, panel came back saying that a new agency should be formed to oversee this work. And to some extent, that's happening. Next slide, please. Okay, let's do a side trip into a scientific finding. Next slide. Let's look back into history. Theory with no data and vice versa. That is, data with no theory. Both deadly sins. For example, Ptolemy held that the objects in the sky circled the Earth. He could empirically predict their locations, kind of. There was no science to support his proposition. Copernicus and Kepler came a little while later, and it all seemed to work well, sort of, but it was still lacking. There was no scientific basis for their new proposition. Kepler, who did wonderful work, died never being able to prove the basis for his findings. Newton and Einstein later provided one key missing element, gravity. Just looking at, if you're just looking at the sky, it doesn't matter which theory you use. However, if you're trying to send a lander to Mercury, you'd better pay attention to what Einstein said, because it wasn't until his theory came along that they were able to accurately predict the orbit of that little planet. Next slide, please. I'm going to show you some data with no theory. That's the four diagrams at the top. Here we have some data that purports to show different series over 11 years with high correlations. okay? But they are really not related to each other. Ptolemy's model is off to the lower right, and of course he never had any clue as to why that should work. What about theory with no data? Equals mc squared, such a famous equation and groundbreaking find. In 1905, when that was published, it was a theory with no data. And it wasn't until several years later that there was data and people finally began to believe it. Another one, going back to 1491, a guy named Columbus said, if you sail west from Europe, you'll get to India. Well, he didn't. He got to Indians, but not India. Okay, next slide, please. An example, I will assert that strangulations in the USA are a function of investment in space, science, and technology. Isn't that obvious? Next slide, please. There's the graph. The yellow line is a linear regression line, okay, duly calculated using mathematical certainties. And we see strangulations as a function of the spending. And look at that. It's the correlation coefficient is 99%. That's hard to argue with that. So clearly, there's a relationship, right? Anybody believe me? Next slide, please. Proof. Lie with statistics. Yeah. The data have some degree of consistency over a 10-year period. All data mining we're going to do. Pair up the data points for each common point. Plot one of these as a series of values as a function of the other. Apply a statistical function, in this case a regression, and bingo, there it is. It sounds like good analytical work. There's no causal relationship needed, and there's no pretext of a theory. It's just empirical. Okay, next slide, please. Here's the process. I paired up the U.S. spending, the green line, with the suicides, the red line. These are from valid sources. Okay, now take the next step and plot one as a function of the other. Next slide, please. And there you go. If it looks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. Those are class features. But is it the duck? That's what forensic science seeks to find. How big are its feet? How long are its legs and bill, etc.? These are accidental features. In order to identify the duck, the features must be measured with known accuracy. That's data. The features must be combined in a valid mathematical way. That's both theory and calculation. And the degree to which foot size, leg length, etc., are unique to specifying individuals in that population, that must be known. That's the calculation. Then you can say something like, this is the duck and none other with 95% confidence. Notice that confidence interval. Very crucial. Next slide, please. Let's look at that again. Let's say we're going to measure foot length. Okay, that's the horizontal black line at the bottom. So we go from, on the left, very low values of foot length, and on the right side, we've got the higher values. And we make a bunch of measurements, and the number of measurements dictates where the yellow line goes. So that's the number of times we measured a particular foot length. So maybe we made 1,000 measurements, and we get a nice smooth curve, and that's the famous bell-shaped curve in this case. Readings that are extremely on the left or extremely on the right are outside of the range of that central tendency. They probably do not belong to this set. The ones that are near the middle probably do. Okay? This is the basis for a lot of statistical comparison. Next slide, please. You can cascade these. So on the bottom level, we have, let's say, foot length on the left, bill size in the middle, and wingtip to wingtip on the right. So we made all of those measurements. We did the appropriate calculations. That's the blue ellipse in the middle. So we did that all according to theory and mathematics. And we come up with a overall distribution of our measurements. And again, the one in the middle is probably right, and the ones on the ends are probably not. The important thing is we can calculate the probability that what we're saying is true. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's look into science. Let's say you were to write a scientific paper and submit it to a journal for review. You will get comments back from reviewers. They call them referees. And they will have all kinds of questions. And those kinds of questions typically will fit into these three areas. Theory. The layers of proven theories that came before you. Einstein used Helmholtz, Lorentz, many others that came before him to come up with his theory. The relationships are conclusively demonstrated. That is, the relationships among those theories. They are not just elegantly stated suppositions. Easy to do that. One term that I remember was, it's a pile of bullshit with an ethereal glow. Data. You need to have measurements with known reliabilities, that is, error rates. No measurement is perfect. It is not just subjective observations because they can vary too much and you don't know how much. Calculation. The overall opinion is based on proper calculations from the data. Probability of accuracy of a finding needs to be properly calculated. Next slide, please. What to look for in an expert? Well, there are some issues here. They understand the scientific theory that underlies what they're talking about. There are a lot of people who have come to their positions because they've been pushing the buttons for many years and they know how to do it. But they don't know when they're out of range. They don't know when they're doing something that's not right. Procedures and methods have to be consistent with the scientific basis for the whole initiative. They have to be trained and tested. Tested initially for competency and then to regular proficiency tests. They must be taught not to overstate opinions, and we'll come back to that several times. Next slide, please. The jury is charged with finding whether or not there is reasonable doubt, and the yellow comes from standard jury instruction. All reasonable doubt, not all possible doubt. This is why a probability statement should be provided. Without that, you don't know whether it's a reasonable doubt or just a possible doubt. Suspicion and speculation do not suffice. This is why the methods must have clear scientific basis. Next slide, please. Okay, let's look at several disciplines, and as we go through, we're going to, in particular, test it for whether or not there's a theoretical basis, whether or not the data is robust, and whether or not the calculation is proper given the theory that is being espoused. Okay, next. Let's start with DNA. The overall, we're going to walk through this list of features. I won't read it to you. You can read it yourself. You'll see this over and over again. Next. Most of a person's DNA is identical to that of most other people. In fact, 98% of it is consistent with what you'll find in a chimpanzee or a bonobo. But certain key segments have high variability among people. Those are things that deal with the color of the eyes, the length of the legs, and specific features that you see in individuals, and even more specific in terms of other anatomical variables. There have been numerous tests of these, and it's known what the variabilities of these key segments are. You'll hear the term allele if you do any DNA work, and that's what they're talking about, is these key segments. The presence of these key segments in a sample is what you use to create a profile. So you'll hear a DNA profile of a donor sample. The next step is to compute the probability that a question sample, that is from something you found at a crime scene, is from the same person as the exemplar that you took as a swab. And you'll utilize the aggregated probability to support your opinion. Next slide, please. General procedure, crime scene samples are processed. DNA is extracted. Specialized methods are used to increase the size of very small samples. All of these things have been tested and tested and tested. Presence of selected segments of the DNA molecules are measured using specialized methods and devices. You'll find them in every lab. The result is a profile of the donor, complete with the probabilities. Statement of the probability that the crime scene profile is the same as the known sample is calculated. Let me just say, I could take you to most research university campuses, and we can find the area in the medical building or the biology department where they're doing this research. It's ongoing, and it will continue. Okay, next slide, please. Plant features, well, is it human DNA or some other animal or plant? Can you determine the sex of the donor? Is that correct? By the way, there have been a few, and I mean a few, odd cases where an individual has two DNA profiles in different parts of their body. That's an interesting situation. You're not likely to run into that. The degree to which the features indicate the sample is derived from more than a single individual, that can be determined. The quality of the DNA sample is adequate for further analysis. Sometimes the DNA is too degraded and you just can't make a proper analysis. Okay, that would be class features, and there are others. Accidental features. Each individual inherits his or her DNA, one copy from each parent. So there's two versions of it in there in some instances. Sometimes you'll get two samples that are identical. Both mother and father have the same. Or they could be different. And each segment, there are these two different copies. Next slide, please. Measurement of features. That's the data part of our analysis. Special methods cut the DNA sample to various segments. They separate the segments. They measure the amounts of those. And the presence, there's a process for that too, because it needs to be more than just a trace account, amount. Those key segments are recorded, and this is the profile. Next slide, please. The presence and probability information, that's the raw data. The probability of the existence of the aggregation is combined from the raw data using predetermined, scientifically proven mathematical functions. And finally, you would compare the two samples and draw a conclusion. Next slide, please. At trial, a typical statement would be, quote, my opinion is that the crime scene DNA and the exemplar DNA came from the same person and no other, and the odds of this being incorrect are 1 in 10 billion or some other horrendously large number. Next slide, please. Is this scientific? You betcha. It's got all of the features that we were looking for in something that's scientific. And as we move forward, as the report indicates, we'll find some lapses. Okay, next slide, please. Fingerprints. Believe it or not, early on when DNA was first introduced in court, one judge is quoted as saying, no, we need something more reliable like fingerprints. Okay. So let's look into fingerprints. And we've got a nice 10-print card. Next slide, please. Each person is assumed to be born with a unique set of friction ridges. That's what they call the lines that you see in the fingerprint on the tips of their fingers. Whether they're really there for friction purposes is to be determined, but it does help. But whether evolution put them there for that reason or not, who only knows. Those features are assumed to be durable over most of that person's life. You probably can't see my fingerprints, and you couldn't even if you had a machine right up here, because most of my fingerprints are worn out and gone. Impressions of those markings can be left behind when that person touches something. Except for me, I just use a blob. I was supposed to be cleared for secret work, and I had to submit 10-print cards to the FBI, and they kept rejecting them because they couldn't read them. And finally, the head of the fingerprint department at the local crime lab had to write a letter saying, he doesn't have fingerprints. Watch out, all you people. Okay, those impressions can be made visible in various ways. Those have been researched. And then there's a visual comparison of a print to an exemplar and a determination of its provenance, and it's believed that that's reliable. Okay, next slide, please. There are several procedures to retrieve fingerprints. They can be reliably rendered as visible. The print can be checked against the database of existing prints, which, by the way, does not give you a hit. It gives you several comparable candidates. Okay, so it doesn't know exactly whose print that is. It says, here's 10, 15, maybe 20. It could be one of them. An examiner then compares the unknown prints to the ones on file that came from the fingerprint machine. And a determination is made based on similarity between the known and the exemplar. Next slide, please. Class features. Well, is the basic size of the fingerprint. Is the print from a human or an animal? The basic shape of the impression. You see some of those in the picture here at the lower right. Are there sufficient distinctive features to proceed? That is a tough question. Crooks do not like to leave pristine fingerprints. They tend to be somewhat smudged. Not on purpose. They just happen to be. Next slide, please. There's an example of a slightly difficult print to read. They can measure the width of the ridges in the troughs. They look for locations of short ridges, bifurcations where a ridge splits, ridge ending, cuts and other injuries, etc. There's a whole litany of particular features that they will look for. Those are accidental features. And they'll put arrows on and number them and then do a comparison later. Question is, where is the bifurcation on that print compared to where the short ridges are, et cetera, et cetera. So that's what they'll do. Next slide, please. Sometimes the overall size, and there are actual physical measurements made. Accidental features are identified, and their positions are noted, usually in terms of ridge counts. Your finger can swap, spread a little bit when you put pressure on it. Accidental feature measurements have no known probabilities. That study has never been done. A listing of the accidental features is prepared for both the unknown and the exemplar. Next slide, please. The listings are compared, looking for consistent and inconsistent features. Some features in the exemplar cannot be seen in the unknown because of the poor quality or partial print. The finger didn't come down flat, it came down on an angle. Subjective overall opinion is reached regarding whether the two prints were made by the same finger. It is not possible to assign a probability as to whether the opinion is correct or not. At one time, there was an attempt to do this based on the number of what they called minutiae. That has not been proved to be valid. They use a process frequently called ACE-D, which involves an analysis, a comparison, evaluation, and a verification. The committee found that that is too subjective to be truly scientific. Next slide, please. Opinion language. Here we go. I'm going to skip right to the bottom. You can say, you can say the two are very consistent with each other. Okay, so it could have been made by the same person. There's some consistency between the two prints, so the unknown cannot be eliminated. There is no probability statement that can be offered in any case. Hence, the expert should not state there is a match, which implies to the exclusion of all others to members of the jury. In limine, there should be, no, you can't use the match. Okay, next slide, please. Is this scientific? Partially. There's a lot of good research that went into many aspects of this thing. The problem is that ultimately, it's a subjective process, and there have been some high-profile misreads of fingerprints, which caused serious problems. Next slide, please. Firearms. Let's look through. I'm going to skip the tool marks. Usually, firearms and tool marks go together. Can't do it all. So we'll do firearms. Similar methodology applies to tool marks. Next slide, please. The theory is that fine imperfections inside gun barrels leave striation marks on the bullet fired from that weapon. The rifling of lands and grooves in the barrel leave marks on the bullet. Okay, those are pretty big. Imperfections in the rifling inside the barrel are persistent. That is, they last. There have been some testing of that. And the answer is yes, to some extent. Bullets from a crime can be visually compared with exemplars using a comparison microscope. The important issue in there is visually compared. Consistency between the known and the unknown exemplar can determine provenance. Well, yes and no. Next slide, please. General procedure, they find a bullet. It may or might not have a gun. If there's no gun, it may be possible to find bullets on file that came from a gun with the same features, class features. If a gun is found, it can be test fired, produce an exemplar. They are compared regarding class characteristics to assure that the sample could have been fired by the known gun. The two bullets are mounted on a comparison microscope, and the accidental features, those fine striations, are compared. Next slide, please. There can be some size measurements, basic features of the gun and the class features. Certain other markings attribute to the gun, the tooling, create a subclass, which is sometimes used. And the type of bullet, if it survived, you know, is it jacketed, is it a hollow point bullet, et cetera. Those would be class features. Next slide. There are fine helical lines called striations. Look at the picture on the lower right. To the right of the black line in the middle is the unknown and to the left is the known bullet. And these are believed to arise from the small deformities inside the gun barrel caused by use or other factors, and that these deformities do not change appreciably with continued use of the weapon. Note that in the middle of the picture, they look like these lines line up pretty well, but if you go up near the top of the picture or near the bottom of the picture, do not. Now, I'm not a ballistics expert, but looks questionable to me. Next slide, please. How are the features measured? Well, basically, they're not. The key features are the striation marks and the class feature, and the reliability of the observational process is not known. Probability of the presence or absence of striations of a certain type, those are not known. Next slide, please. Aggregation of those is pretty much a mental process. The expert looking at it says, looks like a match to me. Okay, it's not quite that simple. I'm overstating that. But there is no mathematical process that is used. Next. Opinion language. Okay, I swear to God, this made my... I had to read these six times before I understood them. These come from the Association of Firearms and Tool Marks Examiners. And I'll read it to you because it's hard to deal with. An examiner may opine that a bullet came from a specific gun when there is sufficient agreement between the sets of striations on the exemplar and the unknown. So that leaves the question of what do we mean by sufficient agreement. Further on in that document, it says, when it exceeds the best breed demonstrated between marks known to have been produced by a different gun and consistent with the agreement demonstrated by the marks known to have produced by the same gun. Duh. What other gun? The experts will tell you, well, they have a library of guns of various and sundry types, and they use those as the other gun, a different gun. But there's nothing special about those. They just happen to be the ones they have in the closet. That's a hard thing to be. Next. The scientific, well, our governor in the state of Indiana last term used to say, when you're playing at tennis and not keeping score, you're just volleying. Okay, they're not measuring anything. They are not computing anything. They are making subjective decisions. Some of these things can be measured, but not very many. There's scant attention paid to accidental features that are hidden from view, like that bullet that we saw where there was a discordance at the top of the picture. Next slide, please. Footwear, okay. These impressions made in the ground that can tie an impression in the sand or the mud or the snow to a particular shoe. Ooh, okay. Let's go through that. By the way, there's some examples of what is being compared. Okay, next slide. Tread patterns on shoes leave impressions. Those impressions can be reproduced. Some patterns are due to accidental wear, that is, a chip off a little nub that should have been there or a crack in a land. Representations of the patterns of imperfections can be visually compared. There we go again. Consistency between the known, unknown, I'm sorry, and the exemplar can determine provenance of the unknown. That's a leap. Next. Photos or casts can be taken. You saw what some of them look like. And those are not made up. Those are real impressions. The tread from the pattern can be compared. The suspect shoe, if, when and if the suspect shoes are found, the treads are photographed. Listing of identifiable features is observed. The two photos are compared, usually by overlay. And it's also possible to measure the distance between steps to get some kind of a guess as to how tall the individual was. Sometimes, well, we'll get to it later. Sometimes the shoe is not, does not belong to the wearer. Next. Last features, the tread pattern and the overall size. Next. The cuts, cracks, and defects, wear patterns, fine details, including shallow mark lines are, that's the way the typical material used to make soles of shoes, they wear, leaving very, very fine lines. Sometimes those show up. Fine cuts, sometimes they show up. And then the distance between steps if you want to try to estimate height. Next, please. Distance between adjacent steps can be measured. Overall size of the impression can be measured. Size of key parts of the tread pattern can be measured. Everything else, subjective opinion. Next slide. They can make a list of areas where they seem to be consistent. And again, mentally make a determination whether or not there's more consistency than inconsistency, and therefore they can ascribe a pattern to a shoe. There have been some clear cases where it was astounding how good a job they did, and there are some cases where it wasn't used in court because it was deemed unreliable. Next case, next slide. Opinion language. I am going to say again, shoe size and tread pattern are generally good. However, there have been cases of knockoffs. That is, they're made in some back room somewhere in the Orient. Or they pick the tread off of somebody else's shoe and put it on theirs. Those have happened. It's possible to say whether they're consistent. It's hard to say whether they're really consistent. There are no known probabilities associated with any of the accidental features, and so no overall probability can be stated. Next slide, please. Is this scientific? When there's a whole lot of consistent accidental features and no inconsistent features, then the probability is higher, but you could say that. But most of this is based on visual examination and subjective judgment. I might say that there is currently technology that is in the development phase where three-dimensional photography is used to make an impression, measurement of the impression itself, and that is quite precise. Taking that a step further, if you find a shoe and make a three-dimensional impression of that shoe, we can let the computer do an all-points comparison between the two and tell us what the probability of the two being a match really is. That is work in progress, assuming some more funding comes through. Next slide, please. Bite marks. We're going to go through the same thing. You see a pristine bite mark, they're rarely that good. And you're going to see an impression of the suspect's teeth on the right. And an odontologist, a forensic odontologist, will make comparisons to determine did those teeth make that bite mark. Next slide, please. By the way, in one famous case, the bite mark was in a piece of cheese, and that man was sentenced to death. John Wayne Gacy. the shape, size, et cetera, of the bite mark are reflective of the dentition of the individual. And the photos can be visually compared, and consistency between the unknown and the exemplar can determine the provenance of the unknown. Next slide, please. If a bite mark is found on a corpse or a living person, or some inanimate object, example, the cheese, the bite mark is photographed, mold is made of the suspect's teeth, like they would if they were to give you implants in the teeth. The mold is photographed, often printed onto a transparent material, and then there's a comparison that's done by an overlay. They make note of missing or broken teeth. Those are pretty easily seen, but not truly unique. Next slide, please. You got to know, is this from a human or an animal? The tissue on which the bite mark was made. A bite mark on a forearm where there's a lot of muscle will tend to be fundamentally different than a bite mark on a breast where the tissue is rather soft. Are there broken and missing teeth? Well, that could be a class discriminator. Are there teeth that are inside others or strongly angled? Are there signs of braces? And on and on and on. Next. Accidental features, you can read that as well as I. Very similar to what we just looked at. I'm sure there are more of them. Next slide, please. Measurements. Today, very little measurement is done. There are notices of the different class characteristics that I just described, as well as the accidental features, but the determination is a subjective opinion. Next slide, please. How do we do a calculation? Well, it's not known. The probabilities of these features are not known. An educated summation of the collective features is made to determine if the given teeth made that bite or not. It is not possible to determine probability. And you should note that bite marks on live people persist for only about 15 minutes or so. So if you have a bite mark on a live person and there's only one other person in the room, it can mitigate whether or not that bite mark came from the other person. But if it takes more than 20 minutes, forget about it. You're not going to have enough. You'll have a bruise, but not a bite mark. Next slide, please. There's no probability that can go with the opinion. You can indicate some areas that are consistent. Some declare a match, that is, this person made that bite, to the exclusion of all others. Scientifically, that's unacceptable. Next slide, please. Is this scientific? Barely. A lot of the methodology is well known, but overall it's coming to a subjective opinion, and it's hard to put a value on that. Again, there's new technology. It was just published in the Journal of Forensic Science. I'm one of the authors of that, so I happen to know about it, where we did three-dimensional photography of the impression of the suspect's teeth. We compared that in a computer to the bite mark, which looks at all of the bite all at once, and it computes the probability, there's that magic word, that the given teeth could have made that bite. So, yes, you can come up with a statement, and you can back it up with a probability statement that is scientifically properly derived. Don't know where that will go, but that's, if you want to read the Journal of Forensic Science, it's there. Next slide. Handwriting. coming to the end here. We're going to write this off here pretty quick. Similar list of topics that we're going to go over. Next slide, please. You find a question document and develop it to make it visible. There are a number of processes for doing that with scientific backgrounds. Exemplars from the suspect, either pre-existing or dictated or produced. The samples are compared visually, looking at special characteristics and affectations. And the consistency is used to determine the provenance of the unknown. Next slide, please. If it's not readable, you can treat it with certain chemicals. You can treat it with vacuum impression if it's in press writing. To get samples of the handwriting, you look for other things they may have written, or you dictate something to them and ask them to write it. The examiner studies each in detail, looking for those affectations and so on. And an overall opinion is derived from a review of the similarities and differences. Pretty straightforward. Next slide, please. Class features, well, is there a left or right-handed slope to the writing? If it's, there is such, it might be vertical. Inclusion of printed words or letters amongst cursive. Overall writing style, there's a European style, an American style. We talk about an educated hand, talk about a sloppy hand. So there's art to this, and that's what the et cetera stands for. Next slide, please. Affectations, character formation. You can tell if it's a ballpoint pen, the direction that the pen moves, or looks small, or embellish certain letters. Etc. Okay, you can read those as well as I can speak them. Alignment of the letters in words, are they all on the same line or not? I'll show you a picture here in a minute. So we can look at that. Okay, next slide, please. There's my name. Can you tell who wrote what? Okay, we've got cursive, we've got printing, and we've got mixture of printing and cursive to tell who wrote which. We had a case here in Indiana not too long ago where a woman who only wrote in cursive was accused of a serious crime based on a letter that was all in printing. How on earth they were able to compare the printing with the cursive, I don't know. But I think I would have argued differently. That was a fake. The features are not measured. There are no known probabilities. The differences might have been due to state of mind of the writer. I'll just tell you this. You look at your signature now and look at it sometime when you're very excited about something and you won't recognize your own. Or at the checkout counter at the grocery store. That's not your signature. Doesn't matter what you write in here. It'll accept it. So there it can change from the same person. Next slide, please. There's no calculation. There's no population to which comparisons can be made. So it's based on the assessment of the examiner, who is educated and skilled at looking at these things. But they have specific language they use. I think that's the next slide. Next slide, please. Where they never use, I shouldn't say never, they rarely use the word match. They will talk about consistencies, possibly written by, and so on. It's never a black and white assessment. Next slide, please. Scientific? Not really. It's an art form. Let's face it. Next slide, please. Overall conclusions. Which of the disciplines are based on truly scientific methodology with minimal reasonable doubt? Only DNA. just walk you through, and in every case except DNA, there were problems with data, there were problems with how the assessment is made, there are lapses in the theory that underlies the whole thing. If there's only a short list of consistent accidental features, the defense attorney should shoot that out of the room. Overly strong opinion language. Unless there's a reliability statement, as in DNA, and validity that goes with it, they cannot say there's a match. That should be eliminated. Expert is not schooled in the methods or knowledgeable in the science. We had a case here in Indiana not too long ago where a blood spatter expert was testifying, and the defense lawyer, who happens to be a very smart guy and with a scientific bent, began to notice that this particular expert was a little bit light in his loafers. And so he asked that witness, is blood on the periodic table? And the witness said, I don't know. Okay, that's what we're talking about here, is the school and the methods are knowledgeable in the science. Next slide, please. Experts should be required to use common terminology and no undefined buzzwords. If the judge and the lawyers cannot assign weight, they should not pass the task on to a lay jury. The Daubert methodology tends to allow that. And so something needs to be done to say, no. If you can't figure it out, neither can they. If the cross-examination later is shown to have been inadequate, that is, the defense lawyer didn't really pursue the issues, then you got the dog that didn't bark, according to the Conan Doyle. I'll give you an example. In one case, famous case here in the United States, a firearms expert said that she measured the hole in the shirt of the victim and the outer shirt and the hole in the inner shirt, and that was consistent with the two of them being one on top of the other when the shot was fired. In other words, the gun was pressed against the victim. It later turned out that that was not a controlled experiment. He did not try the same thing with the one shirt pulled away from the other by a few inches, in which case you would have gotten the exact same result. Let's go back to that data without theory. That's what we're talking about. And that should have been legitimate for cross-examination, in my opinion. Turns out the defendant was acquitted, but that was what I'm getting at here, where the defense lawyer was a little bit remiss in not following up. Next slide, please. Next steps. Congress has assigned several next steps to the National Institute of Standards and Technology, better known as NIST. They are seeking out improved processes and procedures. They are going to develop tests for reliability and validity. By the way, reliability and validity are two different things. If I have a ruler made out of a rubber band, it's not going to be very reliable because every time I take a reading, it's different. If I have a ruler that's one of those old wooden folding rulers, the carpenter's ruler, and the first section of it is broken off and I don't notice that and I keep making, I'll get repeated measurements that are exactly the same and every damn one of them is wrong. Okay, that's validity. Those are two different issues, and the people involved in this activity understand that. They are supervising development of training programs so that people can be brought up to speed. states are updating rules for admissibility and testimonial language. The state of Texas has created a forensic science watchdog organization, not what they call it right now, but they felt that there was enough block in some of their findings in forensics that carry huge weight with juries, that they have a commission now to look at just such a thing. Brooklyn, New York, part of New York City, the prosecutor there has formed a similar such organization. NIJ is funding research into new technology. I mentioned two of them that we hope will get more funding. And some states have provided for evidence preservation. A lot of states do not. They don't say how the blood sample will be preserved so that the DNA can be checked a few years from now. Okay, next slide, please. I would like to thank you very much. I hope you found this useful. And let's hope that these lapses are corrected in the near future. Thank you. Goodbye.